Hello and welcome to another edition of Bangladesh Today. Today we have in our show General JFR Jacob. General Jacob reached the pinnacle of his career in 1971 when he planned and oversaw operations leading to the fall of Dhaka and the formation of Bangladesh and obtained an unconditional public surrender, the only one in history, of the Pakistan Army of 93,000 led by General Niazi. Today we focus on the independence movement of Bangladesh and India's role in this. General Jacob, when General Manekshaw was asked by Mrs. Gandhi to go inside East Pakistan, he told her that the Indian Army is not ready, and many saw that as an act of cowardice. Later, of course, we got to know that it required planning. Strategically, we were not ready because of the terrain and we were not equipped for it. Could you tell me what was the sequence of events that led to your entering there?
What happened was this. Mrs. Gandhi and the government were pushing Manekshaw to move in. Manekshaw was pushing me. He rang me three times. I gave him the reasons. I said, look, we are mountain divisions. We don't have any bridges, there are many rivers to cross, the monsoon is about to break, there's no logistics, and we need time to prepare. So we don't have transport. So he said, send me a brief. So I sent a brief by hand of Brigadier Satna, and Mrs. Gandhi met him in the operations room with the finance, defense, and external defense ministers, and one or two of the IAS. And Sam read out my brief. And Mrs. Gandhi said, okay, I accept it. You can move after 15 November.
Right.
So that was the first one. I must say that Manekshaw stood up and he told Mrs. Gandhi, he read out my brief, and she accepted it.
And, for a prime minister to agree to that and say, okay, fine, I'll wait, it required some guts. And then she went to America and she didn't give any signs that we are going to be moving into East Pakistan.
Mrs. Gandhi had guts. She knew what she had to do. She was pragmatic. Unfortunately, today, no one takes decisions. She took decisions, hard ones. She took it for the Naxals. She ordered us to move, the army to move, and she took hard decisions. She's a pragmatic person and a great lady.
What was it? What did you see when you moved into East Pakistan? Because by the time you were entering, General Tikka Khan had already started his massacre, hundreds of thousands of people killed, women raped. Millions had started, the refugees had started coming in. What did you see there?
Well, I saw all this happening and it was terrible. But before you mentioned Tikka Khan, Tikka Khan was my student in 1947 for a few months. The same Tikka. He was a very ineffective sort of guy then.
He wasn't a butcher then?
No, he wasn't. He was not this sort of person. Anyway, we saw the refugees coming in and Mrs. Gandhi was appalled. And she ordered us that we should assist the freedom fighters. So we set up camps to train them on the border areas. And we started the Mukti forces. And the Mukti Bahini should be given great credit for the role they played. I just want to say this. The whole Bengali nation rose up. Credit must be given to them. The whole nation rose up. They stopped, fought against the massacres. And the Mukti forces, they played a major role in the liberation of their country. Due credit must be given to them.
So you had ground forces support, you had people support in East Pakistan, and you had rebels, which is the Mukti Bahini, who were ready to be trained by you. Who went about training them? Was it the BSF then?
Was it the army? That was put out for propaganda purposes. The army set up 8 camps initially. It was increased to 10. And we did the training.
How long did it take to train them?
We had a lot of disagreement. Sam Manekshaw wanted 10,000 trained. I told him, no way, that we can't train 10,000. We need time, 3 months training for a person and 5 months for an officer. And we cannot train so many people. So he disagreed. And that responsibility was then taken away from me and someone else came. And he couldn't cope, and he had to leave again. So I had to oversee it from the back.
How did you know that these were rebels, these were not mutineers, these were not people from the Pakistan Army who were infiltrating into yours? How did you know this?
We know
certain?
Them. Bengali is not Pakistanis. I served in World War II 5 years with a Punjabi Musalman battery, 5 years, Avant. So we knew them, and then we had people helping us to sort them out and to select them.
So you had intelligence backup at that time?
We had, yes. We knew. And we only took good boys, young boys.
Okay. And so the Mukti Bahini played a major role in the initial part when you moved in, right? When you moved in into, this was before the surrender I'm talking about.
The Mukti Bahini created an environment of fear throughout the Pakistan Army. It broke their morale. They couldn't move. So they reduced them around. This was a major contribution of the Mukti Forces. They attacked them, they harassed them, and reduced them around.
What was the command? What was the goal given to you? Take the ports, the cities, the towns, or take the center of gravity, Dhaka?
Nothing. The only order I got, which we disputed with General Manekshaw, was that you will take the entry ports of Khulna and Chittagong. We argued that Dhaka is the geopolitical, geostrategic heart of Bangladesh, and you must take it. Manekshaw opined that it wasn't. Had you take Khulna and then Chittagong, the Dhaka will fall. We said no. So we went to war with this.
In war strategy and tactics, now this was a tactic that you employed, that you're not going to take the towns, villages, ports, you're going to take the main capital.
The reason is this. We assessed, and we were right, that Niazi would defend territory, particularly the towns. So we know how long it takes to capture a town. It's a very long and tedious and many casualties. So we decided not to attack any of the towns, to bypass the towns and go straight for Dhaka. That was our strategy. Go a subsidiary tracks, not a main road, and from go to Dhaka from many directions.
And also, even if you had taken the towns, you didn't have enough troops to hold those towns,
no,
isn't it?
No, we didn't have enough troops.
You had what, 2,000, barely, or 2,000 troops, or 3,000?
No, we had enough. We had about five divisions.
Five divisions. Now, that's not enough, five divisions, to capture towns, hold towns,
and move forward.
So it wouldn't have worked as a strategy at all?
Yeah.
It wouldn't have?
Wouldn't have worked. Five or six divisions, sorry, I mean five, six.
Okay.
So, but we didn't have enough troops either to capture the towns or to hold them.
Right.
And there's no point of capturing towns. And what are you going to do with the towns?
Right. So you reach Dhaka. And, very interesting that you went and had this long conversation with General Niazi. And you turned a surrender document. You made, in fact, a ceasefire document into a surrender document. What was this coup that you staged?
You see, the point is, I was talking to Niazi on the wireless for 3 days before this. Let me tell you some events that are very important. The war really started on 22nd November. We moved in to about 10 kilometers. And on Yahya Khan, in desperation, attacked us on the night of the 3rd of December. And we moved according to plan. We on the 13th, we were outside Dhaka in small strength because we didn't get the troops and they were held up by General Manekshaw. He ordered them back for Dhaka. So when we were outside Dhaka, on the 13th, the following events took place. First, the American fleet was in the Straits of Malacca. Secondly, UN resolution. So American vetoed by the Soviets. The Soviets said quite categorically no more vetoes. So there was consternation in Delhi. We got an order to move back and capture all the towns we had bypassed, but not Dhaka. We ignored that and proceeded on to Dhaka. I was being blamed. It's my strategy. UN will impose a ceasefire. What have we got to show? Nothing. On the 14th, we were lucky. We got an intercept meeting in Government House. We talked to the Air Force. We got it bombed. They did a very good job, the Air Force. And the governor resigned and went to the Intercontinental Hotel. That evening, Niazi and Farman Ali went to see the American Consul General Spivak with the following proposal: ceasefire under UN. hand over the government to UN, withdrawal under UN, no mention at all of India. So this was given to Bhutto in New York, who was attending the United Nations on the 15th. He rejected it outright. That night at the United Nations, he stormed out, tearing up the resolution.
Yeah, I remember, he threw it up.
Yeah. And he said, we will fight on forever.
Yeah.
That's 15th night, our 16th morning.
Yeah.
16th morning, General Manekshaw rings me and says, Jake, go and get a surrender. I said, I've sent you a surrender draft document. Do I negotiate on that? He says, you know what to do, just go.
Okay.
So I went, taking with me my type copy on my typewriter, nothing to do with the government, nothing to do with Army headquarters, of the instrument of surrender, important. Mm. So I arrive at Dhaka, met by Kelly, Mark Henry, a UN. The firing is going on still in Dhaka between the Mukti and the Pak Army. Mark Henry tells me that we're coming with you to take over the government. Mm. So I said, thank you, but no thank you. Mm. The Pak Army had sent me a car with the brigadier, so I went into that car. Hardly we gone a few hundred yards when the Mukti fired at the car. I don't blame Pak Army car. So I jumped up.
Indian Army.
Yeah, so they stopped firing.
They stopped.
So we went there, and I had this thing read out to Niazi. He said, who's said I'm surrendering? You come here to when you ceasefire.
Yeah.
So it went on, and all his officers were there, generals, and all grunts. And so
What did you say to him? What did you say to him?
I called him aside. I said, look,
you took him aside?
Yeah. Huh. I said, General, if you surrender, we can protect you, your minorities, and all. We can take that responsibility. But if you don't surrender, how can we take that responsibility? We wash my hands off anything that happens, because we cannot take it unless you surrender. In surrender, we guarantee your safety. So you think it over. I'll give you...
This was a bluff. I mean, he had 30,000 troops, you had 3,000.
He had 26,400 troops. I'll come to that. In Dhaka, we had 3,000.
And here you were telling him that you would protect him.
Yeah. Anyway, this is what I told him. I said, look, I can't give you better terms. We guarantee your minorities in this document. We've also guaranteed you'll be treated with respect and gentleness according to Geneva Conventions. I can't give you any better terms. Please think it over. I'll give you 30 minutes. And if you don't accept it, I will have no option but to order resumption of hostilities and bombing of Dhaka cantonment. Then I walked out. I said, what have I done? He has 26,400 troops. We have 3,000 or some 30 miles out of Mirpur. What do we do? I was pacing up and down. I was very worried. Hmm. I said, Aurora is going to land in a little while. The ceasefire expires in a little while. What if he says no, what do I do? I have nothing in mind. So I walked back. The paper I gave him was lying on the table. I said, General, do you accept this? I asked him three times, he didn't answer. So I picked it up and I said, take it as accepted. Then I said that you will surrender in the race course.
Why do you think he accepted it at that stage?
I don't know.
I still don't know.
His nerve crumbled. I just still don't know why. I was more surprised. But he became very meek. And when I told him, you will surrender on the race course in front of the people of Dhaka, he first said no, and then I said, you will, and he accepted it.
And he started crying?
He had tears in his eyes.
Yeah, but can you imagine? I mean, he had all these generals around him. He has his troops, which are like 10 times stronger than your troops, and he just surrendered. Had he called your bluff and that was it?
I just don't know. God was good, that's all. I said it was God's hand, not ours. It was God.
And so then you agreed for this, he agreed for a public surrender, the only public surrender
in
history of war. Right?
Yeah, and I also made him provide a guard of honor.
Yeah.
It's nothing to do with it. It's my own thing. The reason I made him provide a guard of honor, I was in World War II, and immediately after the Japanese surrender, when we landed in Sumatra, I was given a guard of honor by the Japs. I didn't want to inspect it. But as I was walking away, the soldiers looked at me, soldiers are soldiers. And what have we done? We turned out. So anyway, I made him surrender, provided the guard of honor. He said, I have no one to command it. Appoint you to the ADC, your ADC will command. This will come out in a Hemudur Rahman report in a little while.
And then he surrendered his personal weapon?
That was at the ceremony, later on.
At the airport?
At the race course.
At the race course.
At the race course.
At the race course. Tell us about that personal weapon.
I'll just tell you. What happened was, we then moved to the airport. I had to go in this car because I had nowhere else. They were jumping on the car. The Mukti wanted to kill him. Eventually, we called down. So we had to get to the airport. He must surrender.
The Mukti wanted to assassinate him at that stage.
No, they didn't. I want to. I don't know. They jumped on the car.
They jumped on.
And wanted to threaten him. Anyway, we reached the airport. I was very lucky that two soldiers of the para.
But you had promised him safety after the surrender.
Yeah, I
so
had.
You told the Mukti to stop
and not kill him. Yeah.
Right.
Anyway, they stopped. We arrived at the airport. Then the chap. Fortunately, I picked up two para boys who were sightseeing. So I took them with me. And Tiger said he turned up with a truckload of his Mukti. He didn't do anything during the war. And he came with an aim to kill Niazi. So I put these two boys in front of Niazi and shoot him off the airfield.
This Tiger Siddiqui is of the Mukti?
Yeah.
And then later became part of the Bangladeshi army?
Yeah, he's a very famous guy.
Very famous, yes.
Anyway, when we got to the, once the thing was signed, the people of Bangladesh rushed to lynch him. We had great difficulty in proving him into an army vehicle and whisking him off. We had very few troops in Dhaka. And it was really a matter of touch and go and a miracle. MacArthur had taken 12 days to prepare for surrender. Here, there was 4 hours, a negotiation and surrender were signed in 4 hours. I just want to see nothing to do with me. I later on I'll give you who I should be given credit. All I say is I'll quote the Hemudur Rahman Commission report. After when they to Niazi, they said General Niazi, when you had 26,400 troops in Dhaka and the Indians only a few thousand outside,
why did
you could have fought on for at least 2 more weeks? The
UN was in session.
Yeah. And had you fought on for even 1 more day, the Indians would have had to go back. Why then did you accept a shameful, unconditional public surrender and provide a guard of honor commanded by your ADC? And he said, I was compelled to do this by General Jacob, who blackmailed me, who threatened to bayonet my families and everything. And I had no option but to agree to his terms.
But you didn't do anything of that.
All rubbish. Okay. Even his own officer denied that. There's no threat. Huh. So,
in fact, you said you'll protect. You'll give them protection.
Yeah, I've said we'll protect you. So, I think it was a miracle. And I want to give you credit for who. First, let's start with Mrs. Gandhi. She had guts. She took a decision. She was pragmatic. She knew what to do. Second, Jagjivan Ram, the defense minister. He has not been given much credit, but it was he provided everything and he understood war. He was really a brilliant minister.
And giving a political direction during a war is extremely important.
Yeah, he was very good. Next, Sam Manekshaw. He was the army chief. He did a lot for the army. He stood up to the bureaucracy. And he did the political side and everything very well. He should be given credit for his role in Delhi. Then I would like to say the Mukti, the people of Bangladesh and the Mukti forces. They were magnificent. They stood up and they fought the Pak oppressors. Lastly, and not least, I would like to give credit to our officers and men. They fought magnificently. They did a brilliant campaign. We suffered 4,000 dead and 1,000 14,000 wounded.
Nobody remembers those.
Nobody. I was instrumental in putting Ahmad Jawan. Hmm. The rifle and bayonet there is from the battlefield of Jessore.
Hmm.
Belongs to soldier unknown.
Hmm.
To this day, we don't have a war memorial. They have now agreed. When it will come, I don't know.
Hmm.
But I've been around the world. I've seen the war memorials, how they honor their dead, where, all the countries.
You know, if we see Bangladesh, for a long, long time, many in Bangladesh felt that India took away the credit for the liberation war for a long time. We didn't, maybe it's the jingoism that comes by winning a war, but you know, we didn't give credit to the Mukti as much, to the Mukti Bahini as much. Do you think it's right for them? I mean, for this?
I agree with you. India, very little credit was given to them. Since I was intimately involved with the Mukti forces, and I have many friends still with them, I grew up with them. They did a commendable job and a tremendous job and a critical job, really a major job for the liberation of the country and the people of Bangladesh.
Where do you see India-Bangladesh relationship going forward from this point onwards?
I think it's very good now because you've got Sheikh Hasina and she's a very pragmatic lady. She's a wonderful lady and she knows what's happened. She was given shelter here. And she knows what happened to her father and family. And she's a wonderful person and she's leading Bangladesh. And I'm sure that the relations between India and Bangladesh, due to her pragmatism, will rise from shine.
Thank you very much for speaking to us. We're very honored that you came to our studios.
Thank you.